Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Today, the grim truth of where we are and where we are heading has become even clearer. 424 more people have tested positive today, by far the highest total on record. And to put things into perspective, on the 30th of June, 3 people tested positive. On the 30th of September, it's 424. And also another tragic death has been recorded in our community. I want to extend my condolences to the family. But sadly, I have said that many times before from this podium, and my growing fear now is that I will be saying it many more times. Northern Ireland is at a crossroads. It's if our behaviours do not change, if attitudes to this virus toughen, then on the trajectory, hospital inpatient numbers will exceed those of the first wave in only 6 weeks' time. And I want to emphasise the point. Those people being hospitalised, not people simply testing positive. Combining this with the fact that we are still months away from our normal winter pressures. Looking at the data, watching the trends, and from talking to our senior health officials and experts, I am now more concerned about what lies ahead in the next few months than I have been since becoming Health Minister. But let me repeat that we are not powerless. You are not powerless. We can reclaim a better future for ourselves, our families, and for our fellow citizens. We can push this virus back and change its path by taking simple steps, and we can help save lives. We know what needs to be done. The public health advice is clear. The virus doesn't spread itself. We do that through our contacts with each other. That's why we need to reduce those contacts. Keep our distance from each other, be careful, and be more careful. Wash your hands and wear a face covering. Work from home if you can. Download the Stop COVID NI app. Nearly 400,000 of you have, and as of earlier today, 3,735 people have received an exposure notification to self-isolate through the app. So do not underestimate what this virus can do. I've met families who have lost loved ones. I've met staff who have held the hands of COVID patients in their final moments. And trust me, this virus is no minor illness. It can destroy lives and it can claim lives. And to the selfish minority who are not taking it seriously, I say this. Please examine your conscience. This isn't a game. It's not a rehearsal, because we will only get one chance to get this right. I'm not going to talk at length today, but I am going to make 3 main points. And if they sound repetitive, so be it. We are now looking at a severe crisis full in the face. I can't put this in any more stark terms. A crisis for our health and social care service and for many victims of COVID-19. Some people, of course, can shrug the virus off, but others suffer long-term damage to their health. And some, tragically, do not get the chance to recover. We need a determined and collective effort to defeat this virus. By making sacrifices now, we can secure better days down the line. Simply think of it as an investment for your future, for your friend's future, and for your loved one's future. Reduce those contacts, be safe, and stop the spread. Secondly, I believe we are now at that moment where further action is necessary to combat the spread of coronavirus. Those conversations will happen in the executive tomorrow, and we will have to decide what new restrictions to apply, and should they be to the whole of Northern Ireland or on a more localised basis in areas where cases are particularly high. I would rather that wasn't necessary, but it's inconceivable to think that we could simply sit back and hope for the best. This virus does not recognise good intentions. It exploits any and all opportunities. Finally, let me underline once again that I want to avoid another lockdown. Let's remember what that actually looked like, because there was no one on their waves then complaining about curfews or complicated rules, because it was all pretty straightforward. But it was devastating in so many different ways for so many people. Let us do everything we can to avoid that, to protect the freedom in our daily lives that we have collectively won back. The answer is to follow the rules that are now in place and stick to the public health advice. If we can get back on course, we can avoid more severe restrictions later. Let's remember what's at stake here. We will quote dashboards and data and doubling times and the R number. But what we are really talking about is illness, harm, lives lost, distress and grief. This is about people. It's about all of us, and it's about us all committing as we did before. We can do this. We've done it before, and we can do it again. I realise that we have already asked a lot of you all. I know it's been really hard, and I know only too well that we are all tired. Still, I'm going to, and I will, ask for more, for a renewed commitment, for a concerted effort to get us through this winter. I'll now hand over to Professor Young, the Chief Scientific Advisor.
Thank you. What I want to do is to look a little bit at the numbers and how the virus has changed, with a focus in particular on the last week and current trends. First of all, you can see the 7-day rolling average of new cases per day, which was sitting at around 250 per day at the beginning of this week and is increasing extremely rapidly. We now detect many more cases each day than we did during the first wave of the epidemic because our testing strategy is different. Some people continue to try and argue that the increased cases that we are seeing is because of increased testing. Testing is not increasing in the last 1 to 2 weeks. Testing remains steady at around 20 tests per 1,000 population per week. During that period, the number of cases has increased dramatically. The increase in cases is not due to increased testing. It is due to increased community transmission of the virus. Alongside that, the percentage of tests that we do and which are positive is also increasing dramatically, having been around 1 in 200 at the beginning of July, now around 1 in 20 tests on average is positive, and on some days it has been around 1 in 12. So test positivity is increasing to another sign of definite sustained community transmission. The R number, with which we're all familiar, remains persistently stuck at above 1 and is currently sitting at around 1.4, both for cases in the community and also for hospital admissions. In terms of what has been happening in hospitals, again over the last week, we have begun to leave the lag period about which I've talked previously, that period during which we saw increased cases but not sustained increase in hospital admissions. We're now at the onset of the period of increased hospital admission. During the last 7 days, over 50 patients with the virus have been admitted to hospital. And if you look at the number of patients within hospital then each day. That is an average of around 50 per day over the last week, and today is well over 60. We can look at that in the context of the whole epidemic. This shows the average number of COVID inpatients in hospital from the beginning of this epidemic. As you can see, during wave one, there was a very rapid increase. From the point where we had 50 inpatients in hospital, we rose to about 270 over a period of 2 weeks. That is how rapidly an increased number of cases in the community can lead to increased hospital admissions, increased ICU occupancy, increased deaths. Today again, we find ourselves with over 50 hospital inpatients. And with a doubling time for hospital inpatients, which we estimate as significantly less than 14 days, possibly as low as 9 days at present. What that means is that we would reach, if things went unchanged, the same high level of hospital inpatients as in wave one, in a maximum of 6 weeks, possibly in as little as 3 weeks. The number of hospital inpatients reflects the number of cases around 10 days ago. We've already seen cases rising continuously over the last 10 days, and therefore we anticipate that we're going to see significant rises in hospital inpatients over the next 10 days. What happens to hospital inpatients after that depends on what happens to cases from now on, and in turn that depends on all of us, on how we behave, and in particular in terms of the number of contacts which we have with others in the community. Things aren't the same, as we know, in every part of Northern Ireland. This shows the 7-day numbers of cases per 100,000 of the population by local government district. Derry City and Strabane yesterday was 266, today is over 300. One of the very highest regions, if not the highest, in the UK. There are other local government districts which are at a worryingly high level, over 100. Belfast, Mid-Ulster, Newry, Mourne and Down. But the virus continues to be everywhere in Northern Ireland, and all of us are at some risk. We need to remember the basic messages, to reinforce them, to commit to them again. Maintain our distance from other people, 2 metres at least, as much as possible. Avoid crowds and crowded places when you can. Careful hand hygiene, wearing face coverings where appropriate, careful respiratory hygiene. If you are symptomatic, you must get a test and stay isolated with the members of your household until that test result is available. If you don't have the COVID symptoms, the continuous cough, the high temperature, the loss of taste or smell, you don't need to get a test and shouldn't do so in order to maximise availability of testing in the system to those who really need it. We all have a role to play, and I hope that this information is helpful to everyone in thinking about what that role should be.
Tracy, you're mute.
You'd think I'd have learned it by now, wouldn't you? But anyway, good afternoon, gentlemen. Tracy McGee, UTV. Very stark picture you're painting there. You're saying tomorrow you're going to the executive and you're going to be recommending more restrictions. Paint a picture for people. What sort of thing are you going to suggest? I understand that it has to be discussed, but what sort of things are you proposing or considering?
Tracy, I don't want to preempt that discussion. I never have from this podium because I don't think it's the place to do that. But when you look at what is happening elsewhere in regards to further restrictions on hospitality, even on interaction in families, interaction in communities, distance of travel, and travelling in local areas. So what we have a number of options that we'll be recommending to the executive tomorrow for discussion. But we've always been clear those are decisions that the executive will have to take, because there's implications not just from us as a health point of view, but there's also financial support, there's community supports that have to be put in place as well. So this is about a holistic approach to how we as an executive, how we as a people in Northern Ireland start to address the increase in positive cases that we're now seeing.
One thing that you said was that you don't want to go into lockdown, but if we continue with this trend, it might be that that decision is taken out of your hands, taken out of the executive's hands. What about this idea of a circuit breaker, a short, sharp intervention to try to get the numbers stopped? Because that's the one thing that genuinely will work in terms of stopping the virus spread right now.
And Tracy, it is something we've considered within the Department of Health. It's something that's been considered in the number of papers that will be presented to the executive as well, because what we do see is that circuit breaker for a two-week period actually delays the spread of the virus for that two-week period. But what it basically is, a circuit breaker is a lockdown in all but name. You know, so you can dress it up whatever way you want. We are aware, you know, other parts of the United Kingdom will be looking at that as an option. It's something that we have not taken off the table. Maybe, Ian, do you want to?
I think the fundamental of reducing the transmission of the virus is to reduce the interactions between people. And that can occur in a number of ways. So I think it's right that we'd be able to present a fairly wide range of options, each of which would have some impact in terms of transmission of the virus, but each of which comes with a cost, an economic cost, or a societal cost, a cost in terms of individual freedom. And all of those things, I think, need to be weighed up. But there's no doubt that the idea of a circuit breaker is one of the more powerful interventions in terms of reducing the transmission of the virus, and that other interventions short of a circuit breaker are likely to have a lesser effect.
Hi, it's Mary Louise Connolly, BBC. Strong words once again, Minister, and you know, a stark reality of what might be coming down the tracks. But once again, a warning of what you might do. Yesterday, or since yesterday, we've seen an additional 100 cases. If we don't see further action, perhaps further restrictions, aren't you going to be seen by the public as perhaps someone who's crying wolf all the time, but really doing nothing about it? And as you have acknowledged, the public are weary, they're growing tired of this. How do you hold the public's attention and make them believe what you are saying if you don't do anything?
Mary Louise, I, as I said in my comments, I think it would be inconceivable for the executive not to do something tomorrow. When you yourself, you know, you indicated the increase that we've had in the past day, 24 hours, we've increased a further 100 positive cases. That has doubled in the past number of days. This is the highest number of positive cases we've seen in Northern Ireland since testing began in the current form it is. And our chief scientific advisor has made that clear. It's not just about more positive cases because we're doing more testing. We're seeing that percentage of positive cases increase as well. This isn't about me crying wolf. This is about me standing here as health minister presenting the numbers and the facts that we have in front of us. This isn't about the chief scientific advisor crying wolf. This is, you know, that's why we've moved now to the numerical presentations of the number of cases, number of hospitalizations. For those 60 plus people who are currently in hospital, for those 10 people who are currently in ICU, for those families, this isn't me crying wolf. This is a reality of where we currently are. But it's also that strong message, it's that strong ask. Please re-engage. I know you're tired. We're all tired, but please re-engage for the sake of where we are for the next number of weeks and months, and re-engage and get us back to the place where we were in July and August.
69 people, as you say, Minister, are in hospital, 10 people in ICU. Those figures have all gone up even since yesterday. What is the threshold for the reopening of the Nightingale? It is my understanding that preparations are being made, but what is the figure that really would tip that over the edge?
It's where that capacity within our ICU system across the region gets to the point that we look to the number of beds that are being used for ICU patients, but also the number of beds that we need to maintain for hospitalised ICU admissions due to the normal practices for our health services. And that at that point, the department will collectively make the decision to re-engage the Nightingale facility in the Tower.
Afternoon, Minister. Professor Young, you mentioned there that the circuit breaker, as it's described, you're certainly not taking it off the table. Will it be on the table tomorrow? I mean, is this a measure that could be potentially discussed and introduced tomorrow, or do we need to go through a variety of graduated steps before we get to that point?
David, I don't think we'll be at the point of announcing a circuit breaker tomorrow. As I think, you know, the Chief Scientific Advisor made it clear in his opening comments, we are seeing a difference in regards to the number of cases across Northern Ireland. You know, Mid and East Antrim Council, where was one of the first BT43, and Ballymena Town was one of the first regionalised lockdowns that we used, is now showing the lowest number of cases per 100,000 across Northern Ireland. So to look at a Northern Ireland-wide circuit breaker tomorrow, I think, would not be at the right point in time, but it's something that I won't be taking off the table that we may have to use in the future. Ian, do you want to?
Yeah, I think that's correct, that the circuit breaker is certainly an option on the table. There are a wide range of options on the table, but at this point in time, given the considerable regional variation in COVID in Northern Ireland, I don't think it would be the time for Northern Ireland-wide measures of that magnitude.
And just a second question, if you don't mind as well. We're aware that there have been no fines issued in terms of breaches of the mandatory compulsion to wear face masks. Does the executive have an enforcement problem in that there is non-compliance of certain things in terms of the restrictions because people don't fear any consequences if they don't comply?
I think your point is well made, David, and I think that's why the executive's introduction at our request of that subgroup of compliance and enforcement that's been headed up currently by the two junior ministers started off working very specifically in regards to breaches of COVID regulations in the Holy Lands, but is now working on a wider Northern Ireland approach as to the regulations that are in place and the penalties that can be put in place. But look, in regards to face coverings, it is mandatory. There has been no penalties to date. And I think what we will be looking at is actually increasing the places and the scenarios where face coverings should actually be worn.
Good afternoon, Tara McLaughlin, Downtown Radio, Cool FM News. I want to ask you, Ian Young, first of all, about testing. You mentioned testing there, but we're hearing reports of perhaps some false negatives. How reliable are tests, current COVID tests, in your opinion?
So all tests are liable to have both false positives and false negatives. In terms of the available COVID tests, the reason why false negatives occur is generally because either of a problem with the collection of the sample, the swab, which can sometimes be difficult, or on occasions because the sample is collected early in the course of the illness, while somebody is still incubating the virus and before there are detectable levels of the virus. Studies have suggested that the combination of those two reasons can give as many as 20 to 30% false negative tests, and that is something that we are aware of. Testing is by no means a panacea for addressing the COVID epidemic. It's one part of an overall approach, and that's one of the reasons why individuals who have been advised to self-isolate for 14 days, if they go and get a test and it's negative, that does not mean that they can stop their self-isolation. It's essential that they continue to isolate for the full period, regardless of any tests they get during that period.
Minister, I want to pick up on this circuit breaker because there's a lot of talk and rumour and speculation about it at the moment. You mentioned there that it's unlikely to be brought in tomorrow because it will take a number of discussion. We're hearing lots of rumours that it may be brought in over the Halloween period or times when school holidays are in place. What can you tell me about that?
What I will tell you, Tara, there's been no decision made, but in regards to school holidays, there would be a timeliness around it. It's not saying that's when I'm going to suggest it, but I think one of the things that we have been clear that we want to maintain is our schools and keeping them open in whatever necessary fashion that is and whatever supports are necessary. So if there's a circuit breaker that could be brought in around that mid-Halloween break, it would get us round having to close schools. But I think what we're seeing in regards to the advance of cases, it's whether we can wait to then at that Halloween period as well. Just in regards to your question to Ian, in regards to testing, I think in his presentation, I think it's one thing we need to be clear of here in Northern Ireland is the number of tests that we are doing. When we compare ourselves to the rest of the UK and the Republic of Ireland, we're actually performing more tests per 100,000 than any other of those regions. But it's not just an increased number of tests. We are testing and tracing and using that system to identify where our outbreaks are and to break those chains of infections. You know, in the week between the 9th and the 15th of September, which is the last data I had, we were testing roughly 350 people for every 100,000. That was compared to Scotland and Wales, who were doing 300 per 100,000. The Republic of Ireland were doing about 220 per 100,000. England was sitting at 325. So our testing system is holding up. It has been challenged by the return to schools and the returns to university, but it's a robust system that is serving us well in our fight against COVID.
Hi, Niall Deeney here from the newsletter. Given the differences and the number of tests being carried out that you've just discussed, this might be a question more for Professor Young. Could you give us an idea of how the levels of the virus in the community compare now to the earlier part of the pandemic? Another way to phrase that might be, if we were carrying out as many tests during the first wave of the pandemic as we are now, what sort of numbers would we have been likely to see then?
So I think that's a good question, and you're right to highlight the fact that we did not identify the vast majority of cases of the virus during the first wave for a variety of reasons. Most of our testing at that stage was focused within hospitals. We were getting about 35% positive tests at the peak of wave one. And as we've commented before, around 50% of cases were in the over 60s, mainly in hospital, whereas now we're detecting generally between 10 and 15% in over 60s. I think my best estimate is that if you look at the number of hospital inpatients we have now, which is say around 60, and look at a comparable stage of wave one of the epidemic, when we had around 60, I think that the level of community infection would be pretty much the same. So there's a fairly constant feed through of community cases to around 2% getting admitted to hospital, and then a certain percentage of those requiring ICU admission, etc., which is dependent very much on age. So I think we're probably comparable numbers of cases now as in an equivalent stage of the first wave.
Given the numbers that we're seeing specifically in the Derry and Strabane area, are we likely to see perhaps more severe localised restrictions recommended tomorrow than what we've seen in the other, sort of postcode regions where there have been localised restrictions?
Yeah. Niall, as I said, I don't want to preempt anything, but when we look at the figures of where Derry and Strabane City Council area is, I think it's inevitable that there will be additional measures put in place in that area, because that's where we are seeing the largest increase in positive cases. It's also the large, I think, you know, It's also where we're seeing the largest number of cases in those under 40. And the concern where we have for that then leads into the elderly population. That's what we've seen elsewhere. When that younger population and COVID gets into it to such an extent that we're seeing, 66% of the cases in Derry City and Strabane council area over the past 7 days are in those under 40. So it's only a matter of time that translates into those over 60 who are the more vulnerable. And that's why we bring in these measures now. That's why we reduced the ability of community transmission, because that's where the danger actually is.
Okay,